நீருக்குள் பெய்திடும் மாமழை, நீருக்குள் மூழ்கிடும் தாமரை, சட்டென்று மாறுது வானிலை, பெண்ணே உன் மேல் பிழை. என் உயிரை உயிர் நீ ஏந்தி ஏன் சென்றாய் சென்றாய் என தாண்டி, இனி நீதான் எழுந்த நந்தாதி.
All right, most people would probably say, wow, I'm not going to do that, you know, because I can actually play better than you, Doc.
I'm sure.
If you're wondering if this is actually a musician, no, he's as skillful as he is with his surgical knife, as he is with his guitar. Dr. Rajkumar, thank you for joining us on Off the Record.
Thank you,
and
Sanjay.
For the record, he is the chairman of Lifeline Hospital, a well-known gastroenterologist in Chennai, a good friend for many years, my super senior in school. He's depressingly junior, as he often says, depressingly junior to me. Doc, I mean, how many hours do you sleep a day?
You're kind of catching me on the wrong foot. Maybe 4-5 hours, Sanjay?
5 hours a day. And the rest of the time you spend playing the guitar and bungee jumping and badminton and yoga and what else?
Squeezing,
working out of the gym.
Squeezing a little bit of surgery in between.
Squeezing a little bit of surgery in between.
For about 12, 16 hours.
Okay. But you've been quite a prodigy right through. I mean, I'm told you won about what? As many medals as your teeth? 32 medals, I'm told, in medical college.
Actually, over the years, my teeth have lessened, actually, unfortunately.
So all the wisdom is right there, is it?
All the wisdom is stored up there.
So that's what they call foot in the mouth or whatever.
My wife says I've got it.
Okay, so 32 medals in Madras Medical College.
That's right.
And then you went on and also Royal College of Surgeons.
That's right.
Many firsts. What are some of them?
One of the first guys in the country to get the fellowship of the Royal College of Surgeons at 4 colleges. And then later, in due course of time, I also became one of the youngest examiners of the... I still am examiner of the last 10 years of the Royal College of Surgeons. I was a bit lucky that way. Some others, I was part of the first team that did the liver transplant way back in 1995.
How successful are liver transplants? Very often we heard of transplants and then a week later patients died.
True. I must say that... Even when we started it in 1995, that was also the fate of the patient. In a week's time, the patient passed away. We did the operation 24th of December 1995. Since then, between 95 and 2010, transplants have come to stay, Sanjay. Having said that, I would agree with you that in the current scenario in India, the transplant success is not as much as it is.
So liver disease on the rise, really?
Undoubtedly, undoubtedly. Main two reasons, alcohol and the hepatitis viruses, B and C.
Okay, what about fatty liver disorder? Non-alcoholic fatty liver disorder.
That's the third commonest cause. And now actually that's increasing in numbers.
Which is linked to diabetes again?
It can be, yes. It can be linked to diabetes. We call it the metabolic syndrome. And India is full of metabolic syndrome, especially South India. It's a combination of people having a little bit of diabetes, a fatty liver, a central paunch. They say anyone with a waistline of above 38 inches at the most expansile part. You know, there are people who say, oh, I'm wearing the same belt from college. The belt would have just slipped down over the years till it's just above the groin and the belly will be on top of that. I'm talking about at the highest point, 38 inches, diabetes or blood pressure or cholesterol. That man is in trouble. He has what we call the metabolic syndrome. And these are some of these people going for a fatty liver and then die of cirrhosis of the liver.
Okay.
And that's unfortunately, as you say, it is...
But you've always wanted to be a gastroenterologist and this was your calling almost in a sense.
I always wanted to be a doctor.
Coming from a family of doctors. I mean, I know your,
that's right.
Your father was a renowned professor of medicine.
That's right, he was a professor of medicine. And before him, my grandfather was a very well-known practitioner in ministry.
So in kind the genes.
Yes, it does run in our blood. You know, our children too, you know, we told them they could take anything they wanted, business management or engineering. But both of them, of their own
so
choice.
All the family wealth kept intact. But this is something that you inherit also in a sense. You can inherit your practice.
To some extent.
Corporate hospitals are all here to stay today, of course.
True.
Lifeline, okay, you started then I think you had a stint at Malar Hospital after you returned from the UK.
That's right, I was in Malar for a couple of years.
When you started Rigid.
Then I started Rigid, yeah.
Rigid as a name, I don't know, is it named after somebody or is it...
Yes, actually it's named after my grandfather.
Okay.
You know, there's this thing about...
Are they very rigid about the payments or something like that?
Oh gosh, no. Indeed, many people used to ring up and ask for quantities of Viagra those days, saying, is it Rigid, something to do with andrology? And we had to keep telling them, no, it's nothing to do with andrology. But my grandfather was a very great man who was an embodiment of a lot of nobility. He died young. Talking about lineage, often Sanjay, see, my grandfather was a midwife. He was a midwife, gynecologist. My father was a physician. I'm a surgeon. So
you, mean,
you
believe
can't
men,
inherit.
Do you believe men can become good gynecologists?
Well, in the early part of the 20th century, my grandfather was a very successful midwife and a general practitioner. So I named Rigid after him, Rajaratnam Institute of Gastrointestinal Diseases. And then we called it the Rajaratnam Institute, but patients started saying, Rigid, Rigid, can I come to Rigid? And the name stuck. Indeed, we've done a makeover, and we called the whole thing Lifeline. Everything is Lifeline.
You had a Lifeline clinic as well in South Chennai.
And then at one more in Manipakkam, a hospital. Again,
you don't want to go public. It's still a private limited company?
Well, in due course of time, based on our performance indices, perhaps in the next year or two, we will do an IPO.
Okay.
Then we're kind of looking at it.
You're in favor of that, Doc?
Yes,
but many say that a corporate hospital,
yes,
people bother more about shareholders and their patients.
Yes.
The moment you go public and have a corporate image, then your approach to patients change. It's more emphasis is on profits rather than cure.
It's a good question, Sanjay. And I think the answer is that is the only opening left if you want to be large. Either you must have incredibly deep pockets, which I've never had. I've inherited a lot of good things from my family, but not deep pockets. And I'm thankful for the same. Or you must have, angel investors. I don't want to bet my entire career and planning on angel investors either.
But you're not large enough.
I don't have deep pockets enough to do everything that I want to. For example, we're starting a huge project in Africa, a complete university, a medical university, a dental college, a medical college. It's a huge undertaking, a 100-acre project in the heart of Africa. And I don't have the deep pockets right now for it. So I think the logical way to go is to go public. Also, Sanjay, there's a degree of accountability when you go public. Indeed, if you ask my personal growth, one looks at personal growth and public growth. My personal growth is in a few years to stop operating or taking consulting fees at all from patients. I will do operating, I will do consulting, everything only gratis. That's my personal growth.
That's another hat that you will wear very soon, that of philanthropist.
Yes, even now we write off nearly 20 lakhs every month. That is our official, in our books itself, what we write off. Patients sometimes come in with a problem and the problem becomes worse and they can afford only so much. And the doctor has to take a call, not the doctor, the hospital has to take a call. Do I let this guy go? You hear horror stories because someone thinks something and then people just send off an email to a million people about a doctor just killing an institution.
Okay, we'll talk about emails and an email war. In fact, a lot of smear campaigns also, some of them have been carried out against you, all that and more. Do patients also have deep pockets? We'll return after a short break on Off the Record.